this webinar, we are having Engineer Lim Kia Wee, who's an old friend of mine, and our relation went back a long way. And he's a professional specialist geotechnical engineer of many, many years standing with a lot of experience. So we are very fortunate to have him around. I've always told people that as far as the area of geotechnical engineering goes, there's no such thing as if you are a lecturer, you are living in an ivory tower. Because the very nature of geotechnical engineering means you deal with the soil, the earth, the very earth you stand on. So you must be very down to earth. So there's no question of people living in an ivory tower. So whether we like it or not, whether we are in the academia or whether we are in practice, doesn't matter. There's always fresh insight from experienced geotechnical engineer who can share their experience with us, and from whom actually we can learn a great deal. So, and I'm sure when they talk, when they give this, when Mr. Lim gives this webinar, you will find out that the way he approached the subject is very different from many of us who are in the academia. And that is good because it gives us very fresh insight to the problem. Now, the topic of this afternoon's seminar is practical geotechnical engineering. But from what I know, the emphasis, Mr. Lim, if I'm please correct me if I'm wrong, is on bog piles. And this is one area I know Mr. Lim Kia Wee has tremendous experience, and I myself are very interested to ask him some questions relating to practical aspects, which I'm quite lost, you know. So without further ado, maybe let's give a warm round of welcome. I don't know how to give welcome in Zoom. So let's give a warm round of welcome to Mr. Lim, who's going to talk to us about bog pile this afternoon. Thank you very much. Kia Wee, it's your show.
Hi, thank you. I don't want to show my face. I just show my screen, yeah.
Oh, share your screen, please.
Yeah, yes, I'll show my screen, yes. My screen is this one.
Okay.
Okay, so all of you can see this screen that show the title, right?
Yes.
Okay, I'm good. Okay. So without further ado, let's start. Okay, today actually your title say practical geotechnical design, I'm very worried. Actually, the full title is practical guide to bog pile design in Singapore. So I don't want to claim that now the current practice is not practical, it's unpractical. I'm just saying that from my perspective, I just want to share with you how do we approach this bog pile design, okay? So I will start. Okay, this is not the first time I conduct this webinar. I've conducted twice, each around 100 people, because that's the maximum people that we can allow in Zoom. Actually it meant to be a training for some junior engineers and site staff when they carry out their work. So that's the intent. Okay, let's start. Okay, so you can... The previous video I also recorded, you can actually go to my YouTube channel. I tried YouTube so that everybody can go there and refresh. You can get me through this true platform. You can go to YouTube. Appreciate you can subscribe to it, or to the Facebook, or to the LinkedIn account. You can all find that. Okay, I will show this later on. If you have your handphone, you just straight away you can click on. Now, a brief introduction. Beside the has a PE Joe, I'm also an AC Joe. So I just give you the certification. I'm not to boost anything, but just show you my certification. Okay, these are some of the letters or testimonial by the consultant that I used to support when they don't have geotechnical department at the time. Okay, so these are the testimonial of those people who have attended previously my webinar. Why I'm showing you this, because I want to congratulate you all for turning up to this webinar. I really want to congratulate you, because half of the equation to success is just by showing up. So just by showing up, you are 50% more successful than people. I always believe that. So I believe you will take away something from what I'm going to share today. Pardon me, I have to speak a bit faster, because I think you don't want to drag too long in the seminar. Okay, first thing, we all know knowledge is power. and time is money, all right? So power, according to what you learn in physics, is work done over time, or energy over time, right? So you equate these two, you notice, how come the more knowledge you have, the more work you will do, but less money you will do, you will gain, right? Interesting, interesting perspective. You just keep this equation in mind, Because some of you all here are students, I know now COVID-19, we're talking about unemployment. In fact, many companies are cutting their staff. I know you are worried about your employment, or even those people who are in your current employment, you're also worried. But I want to, later I'll share with you how you should approach this scenario, okay? Now, this is a real starting of the technical staff. So the ground is full of surprises for the unwary. You all know, this is from the famous Karl Sasaki, the father of spine mechanics, okay? Now, especially true for those, I know there are many master's students here as well. You guys probably are working already, and you probably work as a structural engineer. Most of the time, you don't do pure geotechnical works. For the past 20 years, I only do geotechnical works, okay? So I just want to remind those structural engineers that the big difference in geotechnical and structural engineering is that you can't see what you're dealing with, okay? Although you think you can see that, but actually you can't see. Now, let's talk about some famous foundation failure first. Of course, Tower of Pisa is not a ball pile failure, but it is a very classical case of foundation failure. That time they don't have a ball pile. Okay, so it's 3.97 degrees. I have not been there, Italy, so I hope I will have a chance to go there one of these days. Now, this is another collapse in Shanghai, and this Lotte Riverside apartment complex. Okay, this was actually quite publicly reported in China. Okay, if you notice on your right of the picture, there's a stockpile of soil, and this the building just collapsed, right? Yeah. Now, so a closer look at the foundation pile, you notice that they are actually probably using spun piles, okay? And you can see that actually they is kind of a show off. The whole pile is kind of show off. You notice the buildings are pretty intact, okay? They're pretty intact. Now, this is the newspaper in Hong Kong, what they have reported likely to be the reason of failure. There's a stockpile of soil here. Then they do some excavation. It's not a very deep excavation. It's only 4.6 meter deep excavation. I don't know whether they have retaining system. Probably they do open cut. So the unbalanced load caused the pile to shear off, and that's why the buildings collapsed. Okay, that's what the newspaper reported. Now, this is quite new. About 3 years ago, it was reported in Straits Times in San Francisco. There's a very premium condominium that they found out that it's tilting. And the most dangerous part is that the residents are already staying inside this condo when they realize the building is actually tilting, okay? Now, so it's a 58 story, okay? They noticed that they have sank 40 cm, which is almost 400 mm, well above whatever limits you can have, and tilted over 37.5 cm at its top and 5 cm at its base. Okay. Now, he also mentioned that this tower was actually constructed on the loose wet soil, okay, near to the fault line. And also this is actually building on the reclaimed area, okay, in San Francisco. I have also never been to San Francisco, so I don't know about this area, but this is also a reported case. Now, come back nearer to home. This is okay. Although I have seriously doubt it's only tilt 0.1 degree, okay, that's what reported in the newspaper, okay. Third Church Street, if you don't know where is Third Church Street, it's actually called the Samsung Hub, okay, it's actually called the Samsung Hub. Why is it called the Samsung Hub? Because Samsung was the original builder for this building, okay. But they're not the original owner. Original owner was a conglomerate between DBS Land and Keppel Land, if I'm not wrong. Now, what happened? This is a 30-story building, right? When they find out, when BC actually pressed charges on the main contractor and the QP, they found that actually 66 out of 73 piles did not socket into the competent short term, did not socket 5 meters. That means not enough socketing length, right? Inadequate. And they noticed the building already settled, the maximum settlement is 164 mm. The minimum is 70 mm. Okay, this number actually I take out from the court report. Okay, it's actually reported in the legal papers in the court. Okay, Professor Henry Tan from AUS was actually the one of the expert witness in this case. Okay, now, from the papers, he also mentioned that only five boreholes, and the five boreholes all indicate that this location is Jurong Formation. But after they found that building has still, they do additional borehole, 34 borehole, they actually found that two-thirds of the site was underlain by this geological formation called Fort Canning Boulder. Okay, you must understand, in 2002, Fort Canning Bouldery Clay, FCBC, is not recorded in the geological map. Okay, later we will talk about geological map. So at that time, it was so-called classified under Jurong Formation by the geologists of the original soil investigation, okay? Soil investigation company. Okay, so that is the issue. So this is the main point that I highlighted. The full paper, you can go and see yourself. Now, the QP in the end was not charged. No, he was acquitted. And only poor guy that was charged is the IE. Okay, the only poor guy that was charged was the IE, and he was fined $10,000. This is a very high profile case. Many experts, including Professor Browns, was also involved. Paulus, Professor Paulus was also involved. So many people was involved. Many people were involved in this case. In the end, the builder, the main contractor, which is Samsung, reached a settlement with the developer, also had a settlement with the consultant. Okay, I do not want to mention who is the consultant, who is the QP. You can search online, you know who is it. Okay? So you just bear in mind this case. These are the key things. 66 out of 73 means that only 10% of the piles actually socketed into the competent structure adequately, according to the drawing. Very interesting, And nobody sounded this thing when the piles were completed. They all think that, well, actually the ground behaved much more favorable than what they think from the borehole. Okay? Now, so this is some of the famous case history. I just want you to aware that, you know, remember what Zaki said, right? The ground is full of surprises. Now, this is, I think myself, I come up with this design cycle myself. So before we start the design, there's a design planning stage. Like do we need really to use ball piles? I noticed Singapore is nowadays everyone is using ball piles for deep foundations. Do we really need to use ball piles in some of the cases? And also then after that, we do the prelim design. And from the prelim design, we do the testing and the monitoring. Before we go to the detailed design, then we go to the actual construction. When the actual construction, there'll be variation, like what you see in those cases, you got 90% of power did not actually achieve the socketing length. There's a variation, and you need to actually go back to do a detailed design to make sure that the design intent is met. Okay? Sounds common sense, right? Sounds common sense. But I noticed a lot of so-called common sense are really uncommon. Okay, I'm not sure whether you hear me, but I'm telling from my 20 years of experience, I have seen many people who don't talk any common sense at all. Okay, so for this workshop, we only talk about the design, planning and preliminary design. Okay, actually, I'm preparing another slide for the instrumentation. Okay, so for the testing and the monitoring. Okay, so that one will be the later part. Like if you're keen, you all can join next time. Okay, just go to the basic first, the load transfer mechanism. The load transfer is very simple, right? You notice that whatever column transfer to power cap transfer to the piles. Okay, Now, then from the pulse, right, you transfer to the soil. Okay, you it can only transfer while friction and end bearing. So some pulse have they mobilize the friction and end bearing. Some pulse they don't mobilize the end bearing. So some pulse designed for end bearing only. In fact, very few pulse actually designed for end bearing only. Yeah. Okay. In case you are not familiar, my webinar is not you ask question, it's I ask you question. So which load case is the most common? Because I don't know all of you, right? So I'm free to pinpoint any one of you to answer the question. So this one I must ask a practical student. Who is the okay, let me check. Zhang Si Wen, are you here? Hey, when I call your name, you can unmute yourself. Zhang Si Wen, are you here? Zhang Si Wen. Wow, no response. Zhang Si Wen, are you here? Hello?
Maybe no.
Okay. Let me ask, okay, Tida, are you here?
Yes,
Tida.
Yep.
Are you a MSc student?
Yes, currently, yep.
Yeah, okay, good. So which load case is the most common based on your experience so far in your company or in your work life?
Friction and end bearing.
Friction and bearing, right?
Yes.
Okay, you say friction and bearing, Okay, good.
Yep.
You can mute yourself, So okay. Tida, did I know you? Do I know you? I think you sound familiar. Sorry. So,
but I know you, but I don't think you know me.
Oh, okay. You know about me, Okay, good. Okay, never mind. So, Tida say friction and end bearing is the most common load case. To know the answer is in my part two of my lecture in the instrumentation and monitoring. Okay, today you will not know the answer. Now let's go to the next one. Okay, methods of evaluating axial capacity. Okay, this is few methods that we're talking. You can estimate or evaluate the axial capacity by full scale load test. I mean, that is the most accurate you can get, right? That's most accurate. But this is not only limited to wall piles. This can apply to all kinds of files, including driven piles or jack-in piles. Okay. So in case you don't know, some of you don't know, actually, if you do jack-in piles, theoretically every pile is being tested. Okay. If you don't understand what I mean, then you need to go and rethink how you learn what is the concept of design or a pulse. Hey, please don't draw on my screen. Somebody is drawing on my screen. Okay, so evaluation based on soil test, which is a static method, which today we are covering. Another method is by the pile driving dynamics by the cap web, pile driving formula, like Hailey formula, okay, that kind of stuff. So we will focus on static methods. Okay, static methods, of course, on your left, you see analysis based on soil properties. You use your alpha, beta, gamma method. All this is you're supposed to have what you learn in your undergraduate, in your year two, if I'm not wrong. Okay, then the second part is the in situ test, whether you use SPT correlation with our CBT so that you can correlate to the end bearing or skin friction. Just another announcement for those who come in under Norena, please go in on your video and click on your face and change your name. Okay. Okay, next. Now, just a quick recap for those what you learn in school. Actually, these things are all taken from the slides, from all my undergraduate or postgraduate slides. But for information, I graduated from Master Geotech in NUS. So probably is also my professor for my project. So this is what you learn. I just go through very quickly. For clay, for end bearing, usually we use 9CU. For total stress approach, we will use the there is a chat. There's somebody. I cannot see the chat.
It's okay. It's okay, Gary. It's okay. I just sent a chat to everyone to tell them.
Okay, okay. So for the stress, is the total stress, you can use the alpha method. Now for, you also can use the effective method for the cohesive soil. You can use the beta method, okay, which you need the OCR and friction angle, that kind of stuff, you know. Now, this one, give away marks one. How do you obtain OCR? This one must ask the undergraduate student. How do I see the list of people? Let me see. I must see the list of people.
From the chat room.
Yeah, I know. I can see. I can see now. Okay, let me ask. I don't know who is undergraduate student. Okay, I ask Nini. Nini, are you an undergraduate student?
No, I joined the GC and will be joining master coming August.
Oh, so you just graduated, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. So just to help you do that. How do you obtain OCR?
Actually, sign is for me first time.
Sorry? No, it's okay. You say if you don't know, it's okay. Let's move on. Don't waste time. Do you know how to obtain OCR?
OCR over consolidated swine ratio clear.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, correct. So how do you obtain OCR? How do you get this number? Obtained by what, sorry?
It's depend on the strut or the swine.
Yeah, I know. Depending on the stress state of the soil, I'm asking you, how do you get this number?
Actually, I don't know.
Okay, you don't know, right? Okay, so Prof, you've got some work to do, Prof. Okay. For now, I'm telling you what is LTA CDC. Remember, LTA CDC means civil design. Criteria, okay, if you are doing LTA job, in my whole majority part of my career, I deal with LTA projects, okay. So, for most of you, you probably will also handle LTA projects. Now, LTA CDC requirement require you to use both total stress and effective stress and use the most onerous for the design, okay. I am telling you, is there any people from LTA before I continue? Anybody from LTA? Hey, if you from LTA, can you just?
Yes, Kelvin.
Yes, who is from LTA?
Dennis, Kelvin.
Philip, huh?
No, Dennis.
Dennis.
Okay, Dennis. Dennis, do you know that, Dennis? Do you know that actually your CDC requirement to check both cases?
Yeah, but I'm not very familiar with CDC.
You are the project engineer side, is it? You're the project side, is it?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, good. Now you know how to check on your GTT department, okay? Yeah. I guarantee your GTT department, many people still don't know, yeah. Okay, move on.
All right.
Now, cohesionless sand, it's a factor of... also a bearing capacity factor for sand. You can check the figure. So there's a sum number recommended. So ball pulse is 2 to 11. Okay, for shaft friction for sand is also depending on the friction angle and also the effective stress. Okay, this is what you learn in school. Actually, this slide is from the master geotech slide. So I just show you quickly. But you see this number, you must ask yourself. So this is the next question I want to ask you. Why the end bearing capacity factor for ball power varies a lot from 2 to 11? You notice, the ball power from 2 to 11 megapascal, right? Why? Wow, this is my favorite question. I must ask something. Any P here? Anyone is a P here?
Maybe no. It's probably the lecturer.
No, I don't want to ask the lecturer. I just know. No P, yeah. Interesting. Last time Master Jotep, many PE, you know. Okay, then I choose one. Okay, Jing Ying.
Hello.
Yes, Singing. Are you an undergraduate or master student or PhD?
Just started masters.
Just master. Okay, never mind. You tell me why is it varies according to what you think, what you know.
I made a guess. Does it depend on the method of testing?
Method of?
Testing.
No.
Oops, okay. I don't know the answer.
Yeah, it's okay, it's okay. Okay, I must ask PhD student. I know there are some people. Who is PhD student? Prof, who is your PhD student? Who is the PhD student?
Let me see. I don't know, man.
Hey, you don't need for me to pinpoint. If you are a PhD student, you can volunteer yourself to answer.
All right, I'll volunteer myself.
You are? Sorry?
Joel.
Joel, is it? Joel, okay, good. Joel, have you been working or you have been studying all the way to PhD?
Working and studying.
Oh, working is good. So what do you think it varies a lot?
It's the method of installation. It can be loose material at the bottom of the base. So that's why there's a varying stress.
Yeah, correct. So that's why PhD student is PhD student. Okay, later you will know. Actually, in sand, we have a problem. Actually, wall pile is a lot of them time depend on the workmanship. Okay, so why they say varies from 2 to 11? Because they take so many MP case study. They notice how come some M very, very slow, some M very, very large. So really depends on the workmanship. And especially in sand, because once you excavate the soil in sand, the overburden is relieved, you will tend to have some disturbance, okay, has to do at the bottom, okay? Especially when we have in the country whereby the groundwater level is so high, right? So it's natural that this is this end bearing is very difficult to control. Now, remember this question and remember the first question I asked, which one is the most common case in Singapore, the load transfer? Friction only? Friction and end bearing or pure end bearing? Okay, you just remember. Now, in actual fact, you should know most soil don't behave like pure clay or pure sand. For those students, you have not seen a proper SI report. This is not properly like a SI report extract from an SI report. You will see they write a lot of description, on the consistency, the color, and the material. And the formation, what kind of formation is that, right? You have say like this is a slightly sandy silt. Okay, then you have the fine grain sandy silt. Okay, so you won't have the pure sand or pure clay. Okay, and then you see the whole ball here, about a stretch of 13 meter, they only do one lab test. And most project, it's not a research project. So everybody is looking at money only. So they will not have a lot of laboratory test for you to test whether this is really what kind of soil, you know, whether it's a predominant a clay or wild soil. So that is a real fact that you're looking. That's why this kind of practical geotechnical guy, right? It's not according to, I want to check, I want to test every sample. You do not have the luxury in the actual case. Okay. Now, are there other reasons besides cost concern? Are there other reasons that why we do not have this lab test? Any reason? Let me see some people. Ask some people. Ask the. Who should I ask? Let me ask. Okay, Rajan. Rajan, are you here?
Yes.
Rajan, you are, when I pick you, can you introduce you are PhD, master, or undergrad?
No, I graduated, I'm working now.
You're working already, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
I think the other reason is the time.
The time, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, so to time also money, right? So to reduce the time, right?
Yes.
So we do lesser lab tests, right?
Yes.
Okay. There's no definite answer. So you all don't need to worry that whether your answer is wrong. This is it's just a sharing session. Okay, I do not say I'm the expert or I whatever I say you have to follow, but I just want to you all to think when you are faced with this kind of situation, how will you react and how will you actually do your work properly to carry out your work properly? Okay, so I will not give you the answer. You think through why a lot of time you cannot get. Later, I'll come back to this question. Okay, later I'll come back to this question. Now, this is why we actually rely more on in-situ tests. Because we do not have so many lab tests, right? In order for you to do your alpha method, for example, you need to have many UU tests, okay? You have to have many UU tests, you need to have many samples. Okay, now, so that's the reason why we use in-situ tests like SPT, which is very easily conducted and very cheap and very fast. Okay, so I believe everyone should know what is SPT. Yeah? So I don't want to go. The full name is called Standard Penetration Resistance. Standard Penetration Test. Okay, so in CU, we usually use 5N. Okay, we usually 5N or maybe some of them use to 6N. Okay, then for sand, actually, there's a chart you can use to determine the friction angle. Now, and in local data, our friction is between 2 to 3N. If you look through all the paper, whether it's old alluvium, whether it's Bukit Formation, Jurong Formation, most of us, in fact, all of Singapore, I see, nobody use 4N. Okay, maximum, I use maximum up to 3.5N. That's the maximum I use. That's after the test, after the pilot test, I revise the design. That's all. So we don't usually go to that higher zone. But in actual fact, I believe it can mobilize higher. But that's one thing. But now, another question time. Why do you think the friction angle is between 2 to 3 based on local data? Let me see who should answer this question. I think this one must be PhD student. Come, PhD student, any PhD student can answer. Any PhD student want to answer? Hey, I think here got P, ma. I think I see something. I think he's P, you know. Any PhD or P want to answer? Oh, never mind, I ask, who is the consultant here? Who work in the consultant office? Okay, you don't want to answer, I ask you. Zhu Lian, are you here?
Yes, I'm here. But I just finished my NS, so I don't know about this question.
Okay, never mind. I want to ask this guy, Guo Xiang Huan. Hello? Hey, Mr. Guo, do I know you? Your name sounds very familiar to me.
Prof Go.
Sorry?
The one is a Prof Go, right? Prof Go Senhua.
Is it Prof? Is it Prof Go?
Yeah, Prof Go.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Okay, maybe Prof can reply this question also. Why is it between 2 to 3 N? Yeah, Prof Go, can you answer? Or you give us your not don't say answer. Can you give us your thoughts? Why is it between 2 to 3 N? If nobody answer, then I don't answer. I skip first. Okay. Now what about M bearing? You see, we don't talk about M bearing. We seldom say hey, the M bearing is between what we seldom talk. Okay. But you just take note of these two questions first. Now, okay, so the common alpha method. If you based on the Terzaghi and Pax diagram, you notice that, okay, we usually talk about, we don't stop the ball power. When we do ball power, sorry, we don't design what? Stop the ball power in SPT 10, 20, or even 30. Minimum we go is 50, okay? Usually we use 100. So when you're in the SPT 50 to 100 zone, usually the CU is already very high, at least 300 amper. So usually the alpha is about 0.35. Okay, if you substitute 0.35 into this 5 to 6N, you will get probably 1.75 to 2.1N. which is why we always say that we like to use we use in situ tests to correlate and get the fiction. Okay, now for M bearing, just now I say, right, remember M bearing 9 cu, right? If your 9 cu is about 45 to 54 N, okay, and this N are usually we are talking about in the SPT of 50 or 100, but we usually don't use up to 100. I mean, we set a limiting M bearing. Oh, so this one later on in one of the practical example, probably we will talk about this thing. Now, rock socketed pulse, rock socketed pulse. So this one straightforward is the pulse will be socketed in the rock. Huh? Some majority, I have not, see that upon ground surface you hit rock. Okay, if in the ground surface you hit rock in the first place, you don't need more pulse. Okay, so this is only when we have a thick overlay of a deposit over the rock, so we need to socket into the rock. So rock socketed friction, right, is usually we use 0.2 to 0.3 square root of the unconfined compressive strength. Okay, I believe all of you know what is unconfined compressive strength. Huh? So base resistance, we use 3 to 6.6 with the mean of 4.8. Actually, do not need to be concerned to memorize this number, because later on, remember, this is just a prelim design we are doing. You will probably need to do the power test to establish what is the mobilized end bearing and friction. Okay, so you do not need to memorize the number. Okay, it's just a prelim guide, a start off point for you to use. Now, question, can the end bearing be greater than the concrete strength? Okay, I'll ask Mark Teo. Mark Teo?
Hi.
Hi. Can you introduce yourself? You are?
I'm undergraduate.
Undergraduate, okay.
Yeah.
You know what is concrete strength, right?
Yes.
Okay. So the question is asking you, can the rock end bearing be higher than the concrete strength? Look at this equation. The end bearing is about 4.8. You take it 5. 5 of the square root of the uncompressive strength of the rock. Do you know what is uncompressive strength of the rock?
No.
You also don't know, right? What? You which year graduate? You third year or fourth year? Or you second year?
Third
year. Okay, third year, I can forgive you. Never mind. I choose another one. Vincent So Hang Guan. Vincent So Hang Guan. Sorry, are you here? Vincent, are you here? No answer. Okay, next one. Siva Ruban. Sorry, did I pronounce your name correctly? Siva Ruban?
You can just move up.
Sorry?
Yeah, lepas dia kahwin lah. Sure. Maybe 1 week later. Apa?
Siva Ruban?
Printer kalau kacau can move ready back to my place. Since I dah clear the table now.
Now lah.
Somebody is talking behind. Can you off your mic? Well, there's Mary Norina Wang here. I don't know who to ask. Then my Mingwin. Okay, Mingwin. Mingwin, are you here? Mingwin?
Yes.
Mingwin, so can the end bearing be greater than the concrete strength?
Yes.
Yes, right?
Yes.
If the end bearing is greater than the concrete strength, what does it mean?
Concrete will be... Sorry, the concrete...
What does it mean?
The concrete cannot be go through to the rock. Rock will stop at the base.
Okay, I don't want to answer your question. Maybe you still don't understand what I'm trying to ask. You just take note of this thing. Remember the first I talked about the load transfer, end bearing only, and this thing. This thing had to do with that. I will do a complete answer to all this, but you just remind this question because you will find this thing. You will find this kind of situation happening whereby you calculate your M bearing edge greater than your concrete strength. Okay? Now,
yes.
For those of y'all who are used to the CP4 or BS8002 or 804, now we are in the era of EC7. But in some countries, they are still using the Commonwealth countries, they are still using the BS standard. Okay. So now I just do a quick comparison. For those of you who like me, try when doing the conversion time, we need to the lingo is just a lingo, you know. It's just like from speaking one dialect to another dialect, you just need to convert the lingo. Okay, so what are the lingo? In CP4, right, when we talk about unfactored load, when people tell you, hey, what is the unfactored load or the allowable load, in EC7, it actually means the characteristic load. Okay, when it's factor load, it means design. When it's called load, it's called action. When you call capacity, it's actually resistance. You need to actually remember this, or else you will have difficulty reading the code. Okay, you will have difficulty reading the code. When I did my interview for AC Joe, I actually had to reread the whole EC7 to have a grasp of it, to able to explain myself. Even though I can understand the concept, but I still need to remember this definition. Now, ultimate load means design action. Okay, allowable load or working load means characteristic action. Likewise, ultimate and allowable characteristic means design or characteristic resistance. Now, the next one is the most fundamental difference between CP4 and EC7 is that we take a factor on the capacity, okay, to make sure the allowable capacity or the factor down capacity is actually higher than the allowable load. But in EC7, right, we want the design resistance to be higher than the design action, means it's all ultimate, it's all based on it's in the ultimate stress approach. Okay, now trick question, which resistance is higher, characteristic resistance or design resistance? I don't want to ask already. I didn't know enough time. If I continue to ask like that, y'all just ask, you should know the answer. Which one is higher, characteristic or design? Now on soil investigation, EC7 actually talk about the spacing. Okay, what is the spacing? Whether it's a grid, you should follow a grid system or a spacing, and also talk about the depth. They even have a graph or diagram to show you how to actually ascertain this thing. But this is come to a very interesting question, because you know why, when they do SI, right? The people who do SI, the consultant or the owner who call SI, when they call for SI or soil investigation, they don't know how long the pulse were going to be, because they had not started the design. So for the soil investigation people, they wouldn't know where to stop. Okay, they only follow a general procedure. This one I must ask Dennis later. I'll ask Dennis. Okay, I might remind this, because of LTA project. Now, current practice under the circular 2016. Interesting, we divide. We categorize the soil investigation program according to the height of the buildings. Okay, more than 10 is more stringent, less than 10 is less stringent. Common sense, okay? Now, it did not talk about the viaduct that we are talking. Viaduct is considered how many stories? Viaduct have no story actually. Okay, we didn't talk about the deep excavation for tunneling. For crack and cover tunnel, we also never talk. The circular never talk about that. Okay, on what is the depth or what is the spacing? Generally, of course, there is a spacing talking governed by the guide, whereby if you notice in the EC7 for special structures, bridges, stacks, machinery foundation, 2 to 6 borehole per foundation. Okay, for linear structures like tunnel, right, a spacing of 20 to 200 meters. Why you notice the room is quite big, 20 to 200 for the designer to design, you know? So if the owner press you to reduce the cost, you plan for 200 meter, then you have a lot of surprises for the 200 meter. A typical MRT station is about 200 meter by length. So technically speaking, follow the code, one borehole can settle it, or two borehole can settle. Okay, along the wall. Yeah, so this leaves to the room to the designer to play. Now, come back to the structural capacity. Last time, structural capacity for borehole, very easy one. 0.25 SCU, not more than 7.5 MPa. Okay? But now, a slightly more complicated for EC7. I just summarize this thing. This one is actually from extracted from the one of the BCA seminar. You just remember this number, 0.3636 FCK for lightly reinforced. That means it's not full cage, it's not a full cage, okay? And the area of the cross-section area of the pile, you have to reduce accordingly depending on the diameter. Okay, so you just remember, this is the difference. And if you notice a difference, actually in some time, EC2 let you use a higher structure capacity, more than 7.5 MPa. And this poses a problem. Many people don't notice. When you use a very high structure capacity, meaning you allow the pile to take a higher load. Okay, because your structure can take. So you tend to use a higher load. Later I'll ask you you will think another question. Now from LTACDC, LTACD is the best. It's a typical Singaporean mentality, kiasu mentality. Everything take the worst of the both. Right? So you take 0.25 and check EC2, then you use the less of both. Okay. Now, same thing for the reinforcement. CP4 say minimum 0.5%. For EC2, actually depending on the diameter, they will recommend a different percentage. Now, the length of reinforcement. Now, remember the Shanghai Lotus River side apartment, the collapse. You notice they use the span pile, right? And in Singapore context, we seldom use span pile because of the displacement issue, we seldom use. That's why you use wall pile. The EC7 actually require, according to the EN, the EN1536, the execution of wall pile, actually require that the length of the reinforcement must go a minimum 10 meter. Usually, any piling contractor here, in my last two seminars, there are many piling contractors. Any piling contractor, there are people from Keller, anybody from Keller, from resource piling, or whatever piling, anyone? No piling contractor. Okay, so in the Singapore context, usually one length is 12 meter, the reinforcement. And we usually want it to go through all the soft clay. Okay, this is important. Even though we have no excavation, we also have no stockpile like them, we also want it to be relevant. This is now governed by the code. Okay, so you know the intent. You will relate to the Shanghai, the collapse. This is to prevent any lateral force to the piles, so that it can actually withstand a certain bending within the piles. So what if the reinforcement extend all the way to the pile toe? Okay, according to code, if you fully reinforce, actually your structural capacity can increase accordingly. Okay, but I'm not going to touch on that one. That one more on the structure part. Now, on testing. But now only 81 people. Interesting. Okay. So in EC7, they call it trial pulse. Actually, they call it the trial pulse. Okay, they don't call it the automatic, they call it trial pulse. This is the reason why we need to do a trial pulse. In our current context, same thing. We also divide the testing schedule according to the number of story. So there are optimal load tests, non-working load tests, and non-destructive integrity tests. I already specified the number of percentage, whichever is greater. For not so high buildings, usually the minimum requirement is just a working load test. Okay, like your landed houses, okay, this kind of thing, or 2-3-story buildings or factories, usually they just do a working load test or PDA test. Now, Do you know that the more load tests you do, you can actually reduce the power length? Okay, this one must ask the master geotech student. Let me ask this guy. Oh, Eugene. Okay, I want to ask. Eugene Tan. Are you here, Eugene Tan? Eugene Tan? No. Eugene Tan is not here. Oh. Charles, you are here, Charles. Charles Dixon. Charles. Charles is my RE. How come you are here? Okay. Nobody want to answer. My last two cop are more responsive. Okay, now the okay, this is LTA again. LTA. LTA what is even a more detailed testing schedule, right? Depending on the kind of structures. Okay, and whether it's above ground or underground, they divide accordingly. And the types of whether there's a barrier pile or load bearing wall, they actually have a different testing schedule. You can actually go and download LTA civil design criteria from the website. It's free. And I urge students, those people who are coming up to work, while looking up for work, you go and read out all this information because it will help you to shine if you know all these things in your interview. Now, what is the load test criteria? Now we are talking about criteria. For EC7, the criteria is, first of all, is you can notice that it's dimensioned, it's very difficult to find out what is defined as a failure. So a general guide is 10% of the power plate diameter. So let's say you have 1 meter diameter, your failure criteria is 100 mm. Now, remember just now the chat sheet, the maximum settlement is 164 mm. Okay, 164 mm. So that means to say if your ball, your diameter is 1,600, literally it had failed. Okay, fail. Not only fail by serviceability limit, not failed by the settlement, it also failed by the, in terms of ultimate state, it already failed. Okay, so that is a very important differentiation. Some piles, they move maybe 30, 50 mm, but the piles still have the capacity to take. But if 100 over mm, confirm the pile have failed already. Okay, so in our, in CB4, they say the allowable settlement is usually taken as 15 or 25, depending on the working load test. For 1.5 is 15, for 2 times is 25. For BCA requirement, is if your working load must be 1.5 times or 2 times characteristic load. Remember, this characteristic load is actually working load in the previous context of CB4. Same thing, they adopted 15 or 25 mm. But in actual fact, EC7 did not specify this number. He mentioned that this is actually dictated by the National Annex. If there's no National Annex, they use Annex H, which is they use based on the tensile strength to take care of each building, how much they can settle within the structure limits. They can use that movement to designate what is the allowable movement. Okay. Now, from the current practice also, for ultimate load test, right, you usually test to 2.5 to 3 times. And the failure is defined when the settlement continue without further increment. This poses actually a danger to site. Okay, this one I will talk more in the next, for the safety side, but not for this seminar. Okay, you can imagine the pile keeps settling without any load increment, it's going to be quite dangerous. Okay, now, just a comparison for you to know. Do you know how to estimate pile settlement? This one, I don't ask you all, because this one depending, I don't know the coursework now. I don't know the what you are learning this day. I lost it because I think now they reduce some of the syllabus and put into the master. So I don't know what you learn for undergraduate. I'll skip. Now, this is LTA again. LTA define settlement based on short term and long term. Okay, so we are looking at the deep foundation element. So same thing, short term is 15 mm, long term is 20 mm. So what is short term and long term? They tell you already what is the short term and long term. Okay, what is the short term and long term? But important in one of the clause here, he mentioned for ballpark, the maximum settlement at the represented load exceeds 7 mm. Mean more than 7 mm, it considered fail. SRS. At 150% of representative exceed 14 mm, also considered fail. That means to say, even though the quite allowable say 15, right? In his criteria, in 1.5 times working load or characteristic load, if you exceed 14 mm, you already fail already. Or in fact, in one time working load, you cannot exceed 7 mm. If exceed 7 mm, you also fail. Okay, so LTA serviceability limit criteria is in fact very high. But many people don't understand why so high. Actually, and very difficult to comply. That's why there's this another clause. You actually can increase the certain limit if your pulse go more than 30 meters. They allow you to increase, it's something like a trailing limit. That means it varies according to your length. Okay, so this is the difference. Now this is the actual measurement of a superstructure building settlement. You notice when they build up to 43 stories, the actual settlement about 8 mm. So to use 15 or 25 or 15 mm, which is nearer, is considered quite okay. 15 mm is 1.5 times. It is 1.5. Let me check. 1.5 times, right? 1.5 times. So at one times working load, and you can imagine this is not even the live load yet. No, this is just the dead load because this is during construction time. The live load is not coming. I mean, dead load alone at 43 story, we already record 8 mm. If your live load come in, probably another 2 mm, 3 mm. So we are actually very close to the limits. Okay, so do not think that our design is conservative. Many people think ballpark design is very conservative. Current practice is very positive, but if you consider the settlement limits imposed to us, it is not conservative. We are very at the edge of failure in terms of serviceability limit. Now, EC7, ultimate limit state and serviceability limit state. I think this ultimate concept you must have. Sorry to say, any BC officer here, I hope no. I see the name, none of them rings a bell to me. Okay, so this concept until now, many people are confused. They will use the word failure very conveniently. Okay, they use the word failure very conveniently. In most of the time, 99% of the time, unless you design something wrong, you will not even reach the ultimate. You are not supposed to reach the ultimate design. You're supposed to comply to the service limit. That means to say, if your service limit state complies, unlikely your ultimate limit state will fail. Right? So there's a trick question, right? Which state will govern the design? I already tell you the answer. Usually SLS will govern the design. So what is the definition of failure excessive? You notice here? The definition is excessive total settlement and within the limit. In our case, it's only 15 mm. It's totally not excessive. Okay? Now, this is a design procedure. Okay, usually you know the action. The action is provided the structure engineer. So the subsequent step is the geotech engineer side. Now we compute resistance, right, from soil parameters. Then we convert the characteristic resistance to design resistance using model factors or correlation factor, depending which method you use. Later we'll talk. Then we compute the design shaft and base resistance. Then we calculate the penetration length based on the total design resistance must be greater than the design action. Very simple, right? Very simple. Okay, so it's actually the procedure is quite simple. Now, EC7 approach. We have approach one and there's a few approaches in EC7. 1, 2, 3. In Singapore context, right? We only use DA1. We short form DA1, design approach one. Right, just for some of you all should know already. No, approach one, there's a two combi. So we always say combi one, combi two, right? So in combi one, we actually we load the factors on the actions, but we don't, M1 is usually equals to one, R1 also is one. So, and combi two, right? We also use M1, we don't put any factors on the load, then we take factor on the resistance. Now, we talk about negative skin friction. Here, the M2 actually relate to the maximum friction. So what is negative skin friction? Usually, I will post this to the audience, but I think you're not very responsive. So I won't ask, so you don't need the answer, but you also won't know the answer. At least for those people who know, you can go and it's good to you. Now, so quickly go through the approach one for the action. A stand for action, the action load factor. For combi one, we apply 1.35 to the dead load and 1.5 to the live load, or variable load, they call it now. And we don't apply any load to the, we apply a 1.3 to the variable load only for the combi two. For the material, okay, take note. Actually for bridges, there are different set of partial factors. They are not under my scope today. Okay, we're talk about mainly on buildings only, on the buildings. Take note. Those people who do viaduct design, please read the code carefully. Don't blindly applying outside what people use and use. You do building, then you use the same load factor for your beach. Please. Very dangerous. I see nowadays very dangerous. Okay, so please. Now, design value action is summarize what I say just now. So I quickly go through. I will quickly go through. Now, this is a summary. Okay, you see this almost in every drawing. Okay, when you graduate or when you work for people, you see this, they always put this in the general notes to show you that. Take note, this is only for buildings. Okay, for buildings. Now for M2, right? So for M1, we don't take any load factor. For M2, we take load factor. Okay, note, set M2 used for calculate unfavorable action on pulse. Unfavorable, So, there's a note, the value of the partial factor should be taken as the reciprocal of the specific value. If such a reciprocal value produces a more onerous effect than the specified value. So when do you apply this note? Oh, this one too complicated. I also don't want to talk here because in my last two seminars, this one dragged too long. So I don't have time to talk here. Now, R4 is a resistance. So you notice, remember just now I asked, the more load tests you do, you actually can reduce your power length. This is what I mean. Actually, he mentioned that if you do a working load test that is test to on more than 1% and not less than 1.5 times the kinetic load, you can actually use a lower R4. That means you take a less factor on your resistance, which means you have a higher design resistance. Remember, just now I asked the question, which one is higher? Design resistance or characteristic resistance? The answer is characteristic resistance is always higher than design. That's the reason why you take factor on the characteristic to get a lower value, which is a design resistance. Okay, so this is the code. Now, notice driven and ball pulse are different. Ball pulse is more stringent than driven pulse. What is the reason? Why the ball pulse solid should be high? Why is it higher? Means it's more conservative. I already answered you this question in the previous part, whereby why the end bearing factor for sand is varies a lot because it deals with workmanship, because it's strongly influenced by the workmanship as compared to driven pulse. Now, today we will talk only on the alternative method, which is closer to previously what we have been using. The CP4 method, okay? Allowable stress approach. It's closer. Okay, so I will have a short break now. Well, now only dropped to 77. My last seminar, never dropped one. Nobody dare to leave. So I will take a short break now to see anyone has any question. Okay, you can either type your question in the chat or you can unmute yourself and raise you just tell me you have a question, then I will unmute you. Okay, fair. So any questions? Anybody want to raise any question? You can take a short break. You want to go toilet, drink some water, whatever, yeah? Meanwhile, any question you can ask here in the chat. I already show you the chat, right? What's the time now? Oh, 5:14. That's quite fast. Then, because after this, we will go to the actual practical design. Well, no question.
Hello, Mr. Lim.
You are?
Hi, Yandi here.
Yandi Le, is it?
Yeah, hi.
Okay, good. Just you need to speak up a little bit louder, sorry. Yeah.
Okay, sure. Yeah. Just a short question on you mentioned just now.
You are. Let me know your background first. You are.
Oh yeah, sure. I'm actually working in a consultant. I'm also taking a master in NUS.
Okay, you are already. Yeah. Work, how long have you been working already?
About 5 years.
5 years. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yes. Just want to ask your opinion on the transition between from CP4 to Eurocode 7. In CP4, it was quite straightforward. Last time, we will usually limit the design to 7.5 MPa, allowable working load, but when we go to Eurocode, we know that there isn't really any stress limit. Basically, the concrete strength, you can actually design it based on the 0.363 or 0.515 FCK, right? Based on whether you are reinforced or not. Mm. So the higher concrete grade you use, you can actually have higher so-called the capacity.
Yes.
So what I saw recently is usually the pile will be much longer compared to CP4, and I just want to know your opinion on that, because last time it was quite straightforward, 7.5 MPa, we know the length, but now the pile is stressed much higher actually. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Good question. But to answer your question, let me ask you a practical question. What is the maximum concrete grade that you can use for ball path? You are a structural consultant, right?
I'm geotech as well, as in, yeah.
Geotech, doesn't matter. This is a common civil
engineering
thing. What is the maximum concrete grade you can use?
Usually we will use FCU of 40, or I think for bulk pile, what I've used highest is 50.
50, FCU. Right?
Yeah, 50 FCU, yeah.
You use 50 FCU?
Yeah.
Why you want to use such a high grade, concrete grade?
In that specific project, the column actually has a very high load, and there is an existing there are a lot of existing piles, so we don't manage to have we need to minimize the number of piles. So I think the QPS decided to use a higher concrete grade.
Okay, this is a good practical question. When you use a high concrete grade, you will face problem like retardation, right? That kind of stuff on site.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes, you're right.
So, and your concrete quality may not able to achieve what you want. Okay, that is a practical concern of using a high grade concrete. Okay, because you are doing light, this we are casting underground, right? So, that's the first issue that we don't use high grade concrete for ball piles. For underground structure, we use slightly higher, maximum usually 35 to 40 for maybe it's actually for corrosive attack, the kind of issue for underground environment. Now, to answer your question, it's not true that EC7 give you longer length. No true. In fact, EC7, if you properly can use a shorter penetration length. Okay? This EC7 not. But because you're not comparing apple to apple, you are using a higher structure load now. And that's why you got a very long length. Even because you're not capped by the CP4 7.5 MPa. Okay?
Yes.
Now, you didn't resolve this issue. When you have very long power length, what is the consequences of using a long very deep power length. Do you know why? What is that? What is the consequences, Andy?
The consequence in terms of what, Mr. Lim?
In terms of the your design, what is, because you design
it to settlement. Yeah, I think we will have more elastic settlement.
Exactly. You will have more settlement issue, right? You will have more settlement issue. Okay, so this is actually quite common now in the practice. Many structural engineers want to maximize the use of the structural capacity. Okay, and try to reduce the number of piles, and the end have a longer piles. And we see a problem that they actually later on fail the settlement criteria.
Right.
So that is a consequence, huh? That's a consequence. Now, and BCA guidelines now say very clearly already. Even though they don't, the code don't limit you, right? The BCA is going to limit you. You are required to do more testing on the concrete. That means you need to do more sonic coring to prove that the concrete actually achieved the strength.
Right. Yes.
Okay, you can, there is a circular going on before. I have the circular, okay? I read it before. Yes. So you need to have more testing. That's one for sure. And also, they also limit you, if I'm not wrong. The BCA now also limit on the structural capacity of the pile. Okay, not say limit, they don't recommend you to use such a high strength anymore. Okay, on a case-by-case basis. If your ground is very, very good, okay, your ground is very, very good. That means today, even with increase in structural capacity, you do not have to go up to 60, 70 meter kind of pile length. Then you have a chance. But if you're, let's say in a rock socketing, right? In a rock socketing. Now, just now I asked this question, right? Can end bearing higher than the concrete strength? It can. If you have an end bearing higher than the concrete strength, means what? Your concrete will crack first before the rock fail, right? You got what I'm saying? So yes. In your case, you increase, in cases for you don't, you want to have a high structural capacity and don't want to have a deep penetration length, the only scenario you are facing is what, you have a very good soil condition. Your SPT 100 must be very near to ground surface. Your maximum power length probably about 30 to 40 meters. Then you got a chance that you do not have this. Right. Okay, so that is my response to you.
Thanks.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you.
Anyone?
Is there any question?
Who? Can you speak louder, sorry?
I have a question, Mr. Lim. I'm Joel. Just now I answered one of your questions. I'm a PhD student.
Joel. Yes, Joel. Come.
Yeah. I'd like to ask you, just now you mentioned that for Eurocode, typically the pile length will be shorter. So I just want to ask you your opinion. Do you think that there's a disconnection between testing of pile and design of pile in Eurocode? Because testing of pile is still done based on number of times of working load. Would that actually give a problem most of the time? And is that the motivation why the model factor of the pile design has been revised from originally was 1.2 and 1.4 to 1.35 and 1.55. Thank you.
Okay, very good question, Joel. In the practical example, I will address this question.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, any more?
Yeah, I do have a question.
You are, sorry?
My name is Gerardo. I'm working on the as a designer. I'm also doing a PhD at the NUS.
Okay, you are a consultant also, right? But you also study for PhD, yes, right? Okay.
Correct. Actually, I think that you replied this question before, but I missed this part.
Your name is still under Norina Buang. What's your name again? Sorry.
Gerardo.
Jeda. Okay. Jeda. Okay. Come.
Basically, I think that you replied this before, but when you were discussing about the working load test and the settlement criteria on the CDC here in Singapore.
Yeah.
You mentioned about the short-term settlement criteria of 15 millimeters, and uh-huh. Then you mentioned about the working load test settlement criteria of 7 millimeters.
Uh-huh.
So I wanted to ask you, what do you think about the disconnection between these two settlement criteria?
Okay, for those of you who are not clear what Mr. Jeda is asking, I will just say that he's asking why BCA guideline is 15 and 25, why LTFs put 7 and 14, right? what is the different criteria? Actually, many of y'all cannot understand that LTA is a developer. Okay, it's a developer. They are not the regulating authority. Meaning what? So meaning LTA is no different from capital land, from HDB, or whatever developer you are working with. LTA CDC requirement is a developer requirement. It cannot overrule BCA, which is the regulating authority. But as a developer, I can impose a more stringent criteria than the authority because I want a higher quality of work. Don't ask me why they want to choose 7 and 14. Okay? My answer to you is that they want to have a more stringent criteria so that they do not want to have, that means they want to have more safety factor. I think that will be easier to answer you. While it's very uncommon for a developer to impose a more stringent criteria than authority because it will mean more cost, but LTA is different. Okay, LTA, because we are dealing with public infrastructure, the consequences of a failure, even though it may be a serviceability limit failure, the remedial cost is higher compared to a high-rise building that is developed by a developer, a private developer, or even by HDB. Okay, so there's actually there's not supposed to have any connection. You don't need to say that, hey, why there's a disconnection. You don't need to understand why. Because if you do an owner, the owner give you a set of criteria to follow, you just follow. As long as it don't deviate from the regulating authority requirements. Is that clear to you, Mr. Jeddah?
I think so, but at the same time, in the LTACDC, it is specified the 15 millimeters for short term. And in the same code, it is specified the 7 millimeters for the working load test. So even, I think that what I'm trying to say is that even in the same code, there is a disconnection. I'm not even talking about BCA and LTA, I'm just talking about LTACDC.
Okay, so you see, I understand where you're coming from. In LTA, that clause 7mm, 14mm, they are talking actually about the testing criteria. Okay? When you test, if you got 7mm, I will consider it, you fail the serviceability limit. The 15 and 25mm is actually when you design for it, they allow 15, 25. Okay? So the test requirement, they set a more stringent requirement for the testing requirement. You get what I'm telling you? But in the actual performance, when you assess, let's say this structure, your viaduct already built long time ago, right? Then somebody go and do some work near to this viaduct that may cause some settlement, right? So, and this settlement they given you to you is 15 to 25 mm. Okay, they allow this building to go through a 15 to 25 mm from short to long term kind of settlement. But in the testing, they don't allow you to go to the extent. I think that is my interpretation. I may be wrong, but that's what I think. So in short, they want, because in your testing, it's supposed to be in the most tip-top condition. You prepare the test file more carefully. I'm telling you, most powering contractor will take special care of the test file to make sure the pile don't fail one. But for the rest of the pile that don't pass, I cannot guarantee that. Okay, so that is I think that is more on the practical aspect on the QAQC side. That's how they control the quality control. Okay, so that's my take. I don't have other explanation for that. Unless you want to go and ask the people who write the code in LTA. Or you ask Dennis. Dennis is gonna ask Dr. who? Dr. Jaya. Hey, you gonna ask Dr. Jaya why he write the code like that?
I have no idea.
Thank you. Yeah. Oh. Actually, in the CC, they allow you to have some more relaxation of the 10 millimeters, but, you know, I still want to try to find out all this clause of 7
millimeters. Okay, but then I have to stop the question now. Let's go to the real practical example. Okay, now, first question I ask you. Hey, those of you who want to join your profession as a engineer, when you are coming out to work, whether you finish your master, finish your PhD, finish your undergraduate, now you come. Imagine I want to employ you. Imagine I'm the employer, I'm the interviewer. I ask you this question. What's the first thing you do when you are given a task to design for foundation? Or even you go for your PE interview. If I'm in the panel, I will ask this question. What's the first thing you do? Who want to attempt to answer this question? Who want to be PE first? I believe most of you want to be PE right now. Who want to be you try to attempt this question? Who want to attempt to answer this question? It's not that difficult. It's not a trick question. Yeah? You don't think I'm trying to set a booby trap for you to answer. No. It's a real practical question, right? One answer.
Can I answer?
Yeah, sure. You are?
My name is Eugene. Eugene.
Oh, Eugene. You're which Eugene? There are two Eugene here. One is
Eugene Tan. My name is Eugene Tan.
But just now I asked you, you didn't answer. Okay, now you answer. Come, Eugene Tan.
Oh, okay.
Introduce yourself, please.
Okay. I'm a PhD student.
Okay.
In the NUS third year. So the first thing I'll do is to check the geological condition where the foundation is going to be located.
Good answer.
Yeah, and then maybe if I'm able to get a soil sample, then I'll bring it to the possible lab and do some other checks on or tests on the soil properties.
Okay. Eugene, have you worked practically in the outside world, or you have been studying all the while?
I used to work before, but I don't work under the foundation engineering. So yeah, I have no experience.
Okay, never mind. Your first answer is perfect already. Okay. The first thing you do is check the geological formation, which is the geology of Singapore. Okay, these are updated geology. Remember? If you notice where is Church Street, is somewhere around here. I think it's somewhere around here. Very important, right? You see the Church Street. The five borehole all tell him Jurong Formation. In Jurong Formation, you are expecting what? Siltstone, sandstone, mudstone, right? Or maybe even limestone, for instance. But he noticed, later he did the additional 34 borehole, it show what? Fort Canning, Bouldery Clay. The name already tell you, right? Fort Canning, Bouldery Clay. Means this formation have boulder. The reason why they have stopped short, very likely, is an error in judgment. They treat the boulder as a rock mass formation. Right? Logical deduction, right? Logical deduction. There's no reason why 90% of piles are short one. No practical reason. Now, look at this. Practical thing. This is one of the projects. This is the location. For information, you can get free ball log from government website now. Inlist, it's called the Inlist website. You can get free ball log. Now, the geological map show this is in the Jurong Formation. But you see the ball log show? It tell you it's Bukit Timah Formation, then Jurong Formation, then Bukit Timah Formation, Bukit Timah Formation. Why is it so important? In this, you know, at the geological map, actually this site is actually at the border between Bukit Timah Formation and Jurong Formation. Now, if today you never go through the geological map, you believe whatever here he write, Bukit Timah, Bukit Timah, Bukit Timah. That means if today you design ball pile, you run a risk that it may be actually in a limestone with cavity. You understand what I'm telling you? So this is the first thing you must do. And I can tell you, many people don't do. They just rely on the soil investigation. In fact, in the next lecture, I think next or third lecture, I will talk about, there is a court case in Singapore whereby the piling contractor sued the soil investigation contractor for misrepresentative of the soil profile. Okay? So it can be very serious. You don't rely on the geological map. Even though in all SI report, they always attach the geological map. But I doubt they really go through the geological map to find out what is really the formation. Okay? So well, there are many Lorena Wang here. So you please go and update yourself. Next. What is the, this one I give you the answer. What is the second thing you do after checking for the geology? Now, you must remember this is a prelim design. The owner engaged you as a designer. Hey, you design for me. I buy a land in this location. Now you help me to do design. And the first thing you go and do, you go and call SI, right? You call SI, I'm going to do the soil investigation first. Actually, you don't need to call the soil investigation. You check the geology, you already know what is the soil type you are facing. Then more 99% consultant call soil investigation contractor without telling them where to stop. After they finish, they design the land, then they check against the guideline, oh shit, my power line is deeper than the borehole. All cannot comply. Okay, let me refer you to BCA specially agreed checker checklist, which is most of the time that's how I check. Okay, I'm just now you if you are sleeping or you're watching handphone or scrolling your TikTok or whatever Facebook, you better wake up now. Because this is the most important thing. Okay? I cannot guarantee you will make millions from this, but I guarantee you that it will help your career by a lot. It saves you a lot of misery or potential court case, legal case in the future. Okay? I guarantee you, now you better listen. This checklist. First thing, review the adequacy of soil investigation, including the extent, which include the quantity, layout, depth, and laboratories related to the design and construction. Okay, I specify for you. I even recall for you, remember the practice? It should be follow this, one borehole per 300 meters square, one borehole at every interval between 10 to 30 meters, not less than 3 boreholes. And borehole should go 5 meters into hard soil. Okay, you notice here, all SI contractor follow this, 5 meters into soil with SPT borehole count 100. But at that time, they don't know what is the power diameter. They also don't know what is the founding length. So they will not know how did the soil investigation borehole need to go. So in the end, you waste money. Your client waste money. Okay? Your client waste money. In my master geotech class, when I take about, I don't know how many years ago, I think Prof. Chu Sun Ho was teaching this thing. I already gave my answer that time, 12 years ago. When I was not even a PGO yet. It's very simple actually. You just need to estimate the length and tell the contractor. Very simple one. It's a very simple answer, but most people don't use their common sense to do work. Most people don't use their common sense to do work. Okay? Now, on top of this thing, there is another guideline on rock identification. Remember here, including the lab test. This is quite new. And I tell you, a lot of problems with borehole foundation, practical problems are actually rock identification. A lot of piling contractor can go bankrupt because of a lousy consultant. All right? Lousy in the extent that they cannot decide the kind of rock they want to socket. In actual fact, on the field, after you bore, after your coring bucket, okay, core the rock, can anyone actually from the core sample tell me that is a G2 or G1 or G3 rock? It's not so easy. In my last webinar, a 9 years experienced structural engineer, he replied me, this one is a site people to decide. Oh, I said, wow, if you say like that, in the NP interview, I think I will fail you. You, who are the site people? I'm asking you. The IE, the RTO, the main con supervisor, the subcon supervisor. You are depending on those people to tell you whether your pile is socketed in the right kind of rod that you want. It's very, very dangerous. Okay, it's very, very dangerous. Huh? So now, this guy tell you the different criteria to identify the rod. Okay, whether you use the tool, check the borehole, check the sample of the rock sample, and important, you need to do the point load index, point load test index. If you don't know what is the PI or point load index, please go and read. I don't have time. Okay, so please, Prof Lee, please educate them on what is point load test index. It's very important. It's so fundamental, but I get so many people don't know. Yes, Bala Ganesh, raise hand. Why you raise hand? Next.
Can you hear me, please?
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, I just want to ask, in Singapore, what is the popularity, or is a geophysical survey methods gaining popularity for identifying the rock bed level? Because it's a very fast and quick method of checking the depth of the bedrock level. I mean, so is this gaining popularity, geophysical survey methods?
Yeah, geophysical survey method, they use especially for interpolate between the boreholes. Okay, so they will still depend on the boreholes. So in between the borehole, let's say your spacing is too wide, you want to save some cost, you like, for example, most common one is a bore tunnel, right? You want to know whether your tunnel face the grid of the rock that you're facing, right? So you don't need to do a full-fledged SI on the location. You just probably just drill a hole and just do a geophysical survey and see what kind of rock around that the tunnel face. But that is not the context. That is not in this ball power context here. In this ball power context, you can do a geophysical survey within, because usually we talk about buildings. Okay, I think in Singapore, at least in Singapore context, I know in China, in probably in India, you all do township project whereby the whole site is actually can like our whole Bedok New Town or Tampines New Town. Okay, so that's a different aspect. But when we talk in Singapore context, our maximum per block, maximum number of block per project is probably 3 to 4. So every block, we actually do the specific borehole. Okay, so this is actually, this identification is actually for the site verification. Okay, it's not the actually, not only the preliminary SI that you do. Preliminary SI, I can agree with you, you can do geophysical survey, it doesn't matter. But on site, when you bore a hole for the pile, and you take out this rock, can you tell me what kind of grade is that? You can't, right? So that is the reason why they have come up with this, GeoSS have come up with these guidelines together with BCA. Now, the second item, review the site investigation result and geotechnical reasons such as the soil strength and deformation characteristic. That is skin fiction, power strong fiction, blah, 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 blah. Okay, so this is a big paragraph. Basically, it covers everything that you need to do for the design. What are the SI result and geotechnical parameter required? Now, if you use a pure alpha CU method, right? I said, oh no, this is a pure clay. I want to use alpha CU method. What you need to do? You need to do a lot of UU sample. You need to do a UU sample. Now, we may recall the question, why we don't do so many lab tests besides the cost concern? Recall, we usually socket the pile in SPT 100 or SPT 50 onwards. If you have some knowledge about sampling, you will know to take high quality sample in very stiff soil, very stiff clay, SPT 50 to 100. You can only use major sample, right? You probably take major sample. And your major sample, very difficult to guarantee a high quality sample. Okay, so if you take those things and go and do U test, you end up your U test actually may not be reflective of what is the real strength of the soil. So that's the reason why we use in situ test more often, especially SPT, right? It's a direct measurement, right? SPT 50, 100, we can correlate the CU, which is better, okay? Which is better. So I one shot answer you those questions that I asked you before. Now, review of the pile load test. Okay. Remember, this is a prelim design. You cannot carry out any pile load test. In Singapore, nobody adopt the EC7 approach of using pile load test to design. That means we do pile load test, then for the panel, we redesign the pile. We don't do that, because why? Because everybody cannot wait. Nobody want to wait. Anybody want to rush submission, rush approval, because they all say Singapore approval take too long already. So everyone want to rush. So they rather do the submission first, then they do the load test at the same time. Now, question, which load test to be carried out first? Hey, this one, if you cannot answer, then got problem. I also don't know ask who to answer. This is a very important question. And still got people can ask me this kind of thing. Okay, I ask so many. Okay, Michelle Lee. Which one you should do first? Ultimate load test or working load test?
Working load test.
Sorry?
Working load test.
Wow. You are where? You are undergrad student, right?
Master student.
You are working now?
Yes.
Okay. You are a structural consultant, working in structural consultant or contractor?
Contractor,
huh? Okay. Answer is wrong, huh? You do the ultimate load test first. The ultimate load test, okay, this one is actually supposed to be my second lecture. So I don't know. So you just take note, you need to do the ultimate load test first to find out what is the parameters that we want to use, or to confirm the initial assumption of the parameters. Okay, not the working load test first, Michelle. Okay, take note. You, which year master? Hey, this one master must teach, right? Prof. Next. Do you know that you don't need BCA approval to carry out the ultimate load test? Then people don't know. They thought, hey, cannot do my master for approval. Actually, you can do first. Okay, they can do first. Usually they do concurrently when the submission is in to save the time. But to me, it's waste of time. But they think can save time. Okay. Now, review accuracy of founding and penetration depth. This one you know. Allow against URS, against SLS. Very important. Very important. Define what is the competence short term for the total termination criteria. We call the Church Street failure. The competence short term was defined as SPT 100. And they won 5 meters into SPT 100. And yet they all didn't achieve. 66 out of 73 pounds did not achieve 5 meters. I don't know why. Okay? I don't know why. Probably along the way, they have find a more competent short term that allow them to use a shorter socketing length. Mean, for example, you use SPT 100 original, then actually on site is all SPT 100. So that's how you get it. I haven't asked my favorite question. How do you confirm SPTN on site? Okay, from the actual boring hole. Later we'll check. Now, how do you determine? Yes, my favorite question. This one I must ask. Ask who? Who want to attend? Let me raise this question. Let's say today the designer say, hey, my pile must stop in SPT 100. So today, the contractor happily boring on the site. And your design say the SPT 100 will encounter at 30 meters below ground. So when they reach 30 meters below ground, they say, hey, this is SPT 100. Somebody have to confirm this is SPT 100. How do they confirm? Whether this is SPT 100 or 99, 79, 85. How do they confirm? I want to ask. Okay, I think this is my RTO. Mark Edward Fastino. Mark, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Are you my RTO?
No.
Oh, okay, sorry. You from Philippines, right?
Yeah.
Where are you working now?
CPG.
No, as designer?
No, on site.
On site, right? You are IERTO, right?
Yeah.
Okay, you tell me now. My favorite question, I'm the piling contractor. I ask you, hey, Mark, come, please confirm whether the SPD 100 because I want to calculate the 5 meter from now on. How do you check? And this location is not near to any borehole. How do you check?
No idea.
No idea, and you do site verification. If I ask you, hey, which project you don't work in the, you work in the state court project, no, right?
Usually, I just refer to the bolog to confirm the depth.
Yeah, correct. You refer to the bolog, it's not wrong. But I'm telling you, your bolog cannot be every bore pile you have a borehole, right? This particular pile is not near to any of the borehole on site. How do you confirm whether it's SPT 100 or not? You don't know the answer, right?
Mm-hmm.
Very good. You admit you don't know is better than you think you know. Okay, very good. Let me ask another guy. This one very important. Go Gek Po. Mr. Go. Go Gek Po. Are you here? No. Who else? John Lim. John Lim, are you here? Wow. All want to cannot answer this question. Who want to answer this question? Hey, this is a very important question, you know.
Hi.
Yeah, you are?
I'm Minwin. I'm an undergrad from NUS.
You are Minwin. Yeah, Minwin, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, good. How do you answer?
I'm not sure, but I'll just use my limited knowledge to try.
You
just do a SPT test. Like,
sorry?
In my days, I learned how to do SPT like at the lab. So like
yes.
my answer would be like you just do the SPT test on site to determine whether it's like the correct SPT.
Like every borehole, I need to do SPT then.
But you say, oh, like those with borehole, then no need to do ma. This one don't have borehole. That's why you do.
Your site got 100 borepower, only got 5 borehole. So how many borehole you want to do? How many SPT tests you want to do?
I don't know. This is my guess.
But you're very close. Good attempt. In fact, in the market, I'm the first one to tell people to use this. There's this thing called a handheld penetrator. Have you heard of this?
Cold penetrometer test.
Right? Who answered that question? Who was talking just now?
Hand pocket penetrometer.
Yes, hand pocket penetrometer.
Yeah. And then we just press the value in kg bar cm squared and then go back to the CU.
Hey, can you introduce yourself? I'm very scared that somebody suddenly talking like that. Who are you?
My name is Mildura. I'm studying in the MSc.
You are working already, right, Mio?
Yes.
Okay, so you are you from Myanmar, right?
Yes.
You Georgia train, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so usually Burmese people will know. Okay? Georgians will know. This hand pocket penetrometer can actually easily correlate to SPDN.
Correct.
And it can go as high to measure up to as now. The first version only up to SPD 75, but now can measure up to SPD 100 already. And you will ask me, hey, if you take out the sample, the SPD, the soil, all disturbed, no, how can you be sure it's 100? I can assure you, you can. Okay? Because in SPD 100 soil, you take out the drilling bucket, what you take out? Of course, you don't take those you already see is already disturbed. You must take those actually inside the bulk sample that actually relatively stiff one. Okay, actually you can. Very, very important. Please remember this. If you do IERTO, even you don't become an IERTO, even you, next time you become PE, do you know that you are the supervision? You are the ultimate person who supervises this thing? And if you're telling me you don't know, how to determine on site, then if you yourself don't know, you expect the site people to know. This is very interesting. I'm telling you, this is what I feel very absurd about the industry now. Very absurd about industry. And I foresee, we will have foundation failure very soon. Okay, very soon. That's why I want to do this kind of seminar. Okay, now, good answer. You are, Okay, good. Now, next thing, review the ground condition, blah, 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 the test result. Now, do you know that the construction method will determine the performance of ball park? In the EC, in the EC2, in Singapore, we don't ever use permanent casing one. Nobody left in the casing unless for certain special reason for debonding, we use permanent casing. Even for debonding, we don't use, it's too expensive. Okay? The reason why we need to reduce the diameter is because of this thing. Okay? Because of whether the deformation, I have not even talked on how do we do a performance checks on the ball part. Okay, that will probably be in my third lecture that I'm going to do. Okay, so designers should consider workmanship and execution condition in the design of the part. So for those who people who have not seen ball part how it's been done, this is a diagram for you to see. Okay, you can see. Now, real practical example. This is, I cannot tell you the location. This is many years back. This is my first QP Joe project. Okay, first QP Joe project. It's a single tower block. It's a single tower block, more than 30 story. Very luxurious condo. The blue color boreholes are the existing borehole before I was on board. Okay. And the four yellow boreholes are the addition borehole that I call for. Why you notice the tower block is here? You notice the blue color boreholes are actually not within the tower block. Anybody want to guess? I think you all don't have time. You all also feel tired, right? But this is the most important. The reason why they do it because at that time the existing building was not demolished. So the consultant, original consultant, do the borehole just on the fringe of the existing building, even though he never touched on the main tower block. Okay, even though he never touched on the main tower block. Gerardo Pitaro, you sound very familiar. Okay, so they never do. So when I was on board, I said, hey, we better have a more representative condition. So I start to do call in the tower block and also out in the other loaded area. And you see the blue line, right? This blue line is actually the zoning. Zoning, okay, for those practical design, you know, right? We zone the site such that we will decide this zone, what is the representative borehole we use for design. And you notice how I zone, I zone very complicated here. Right? Very complicated. You see how I zone this main tower block. This zone is covered by so big area is covered by this borehole. Nowadays, when I have checked more than 10 projects every year, I see the way they zone. Wow, they zone the ground as if the zone, the borehole condition will follow according to their zone. Okay, they ideally zone the site like a grid and idealistically assume the ground will also behave like a grid. This is very dangerous. Actually, the zoning part is the most difficult thing part and very difficult to do. Okay? Now, how do you classify different zone? I don't have time to cover here, but I just want to highlight to all of y'all who are doing design in the design office, you better pay attention how you classify the zone. Okay, it's not so simple. Okay, I cannot have time to cover here. Probably I will have to do another lecture to tell you how to do this thing. Okay, there are many things to consider, okay? Now, the actual soil condition may be more complicated than what you think. You look at here, this soil profile. They thought there's a rock. The rock here is very high here. Okay, you see the red part is the red color is the rock. But in between the rock, there's no rock. There's a deep valley below. If your design based on only rock socketing, that the piles must reach the rock. Well, I tell you, in this project, the piling contractor will go bankrupt because he can never find the rock. You see here, he can never find out. The rock probably go much deeper than what is being shown here. Okay, so real life problems. These are real life. Many piling contractor, when they see rock formation, any rock piles, rock socketed piles, yeah, they are, well, I tell you, they almost every night they cannot sleep. I tell you, if they see the consultant, they know don't know how to do one. They even more worried. Okay. Now I'll give you one example. This is a real example. Let's take for example. This is this one borehole. Okay. This is the piles is a 2-pile group. This pile is a 800 mm diameter. This is a standard notes. Okay, the parameters already designated by the consultant is 2.5N for soil. Okay, for soil. G5, G4, G3, anything less than 100 is 2.5N, less than 250. For G2 better, G2, or that means it's rock, the rock friction is 400. And for M bearing, it's not more than 6,000. For the rock, it's not more than 8,000. Now, this is what you have now. This is what the structure consultant give to you now. The load, okay? He will give you the load. Where's the load? The load is here. Okay, the C1 load is 6152, 615 ton. The C2 load is 472 ton. So there's a C1 load, the design combi one load. Action, sorry, I should use the word action. This is the action. This is already the design action, not the characteristic action, design action. Now, combi one, combi one, the model factor is 1.35. What you need to do is the resistance, the design resistance, RST stands for design resistance, shaft design resistance, is 2.5N for combi one, is 2.5N divided by R4, which is 1, and divided by the model factor. Okay, this thing cannot be more than 250. The end bearing here cannot measure 6,000. The end measure 6,000. So it will not, because the end maximum is 100. So 6,000 divided by 1.35 can never exceed 100. Likewise, this one also can never exceed 450. For the rock, right? Same thing. You will not exceed 400. You always 296 and 5926. Okay, so this is actually how you do the design. Likewise, you calculate for combi 2. Now you have a R4 factor which is more than 1. That means your resistance is lesser. Your end bearing also lesser accordingly. Now, one more criteria required by VCA is that you need to check the characteristic shaft resistance should not be less than 1.37 the characteristic load. If you can recall, this is similar to CP4, that we always do a friction check only, which whereby the friction divided by 1.5 must be higher than the allowable load. So we need to check, we need to get the characteristic load. Now, remember I show you previously, the information given to you, these two are the design action. They are not the characteristic action. So you need to find out the characteristic action. Usually you get from the structural consultant, they will give it to you. So this is the thing, okay? This is the thing. You need to check the friction. Now for LTACDC requirement, right? Instead of 1.3, they use 1.5. They follow the CP4, but they use the EC7 definition, okay? Now, how do we go about? What is the purpose of ignoring the end bearing in this check? This question I keep asking, this is the third time, right? Why? Same thing, because of workmanship. You will know that the ball power end bearing is very difficult to maintain and difficult to achieve. Even you can achieve for a few power, you may not achieve for all the powers. So that's the reason why you need to, we ignore. This is additional criteria. That means we base on friction only. Remember the first question I asked? What's the common pulse? End bearing, friction, or end bearing plus friction. Later you will see, the checking will tell you which one is governing. Now this is the ball lock. COL stands for cow level. So this job got two engineers, engineer A and engineer B. The diameter is 0.8 meter, the cross section shaft area is 2.51, cross section 0.5. Now, this is the 1808424 are the characteristic load. You just take note. So I already divide the soil layer accordingly to the SPT. So there's a 4, 8, 15. Okay, this particular borehole you see here, there's a 7 meter of, I will not say it's boulder, it's too big. I don't know whether it's a boulder. It's likely to be a boulder. Then we have soil. Then we hit the rock. So these two engineers, engineer A, design all the way the rock socketing is based on here, passing through the boulder. Engineer B decide to socket into the boulder. Now, engineer A design. He design needs 19 meter. Okay? He's treating the boulder. You look at here, the highlight 15, number 15. He treat this boulder as a soil with only SPT 15. Why 15? Because the previous soil layer is 15. The soil layer above this boulder is 15. Okay? So he do the check. You notice, the over design factor, the lowest over design factor is a shaft check only. Means actually this part is a pure fiction part, it's pure fiction governing. Pure fiction, that means I don't need the end bearing. It can pass. Okay, but with a lower safety factor, which is only 1.3, right? So this is a shaft check only. Now, which one you use? Because notice below one is 46, above is 15. Which one will you use? Now, shaft B, shaft B design only 10.9 meter because he only socket into the boulder. Do you notice in both design, the shaft check is governing? Okay? So the most, that's why BCA throw in this criteria. Actually, not say it throw in, but all the while we have to do this, the shaft fission check only. And usually these are the one governing. Because some consultant like to use a very high end bearing. Okay, like to use a very high bearing. In the Church Street case, the end bearing for the ballpark is 12,000 kPa. It is 12 MPa. Much higher than the recommended value from 2 to 11. Okay, much higher. Both the QP and AC adopted 12 MPa. This itself is already very, very dangerous. Okay, take note. So, how? Now my question to you. Is engineer B a better engineer? He designed a shorter power length. So I will ask Gerardo Pitaro from Italy. Are you from Italy, Gerardo?
Yes and no. I mean, I'm from Argentina, but I am also Italian.
Sorry?
I am from Argentina.
Argentina? Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Are you from LTA?
No, I'm working in McDonald's.
Oh, okay. So Argentina. Okay, good.
Yes.
So, which one is a better engineer?
I just got an internet connection, but I understand that you were asking which one between engineer A and engineer B will you choose, right?
Yeah, you decide. I'm not you choose. Now I'm asking you choose. Which one is a better engineer? Okay. Or if you are the designer, you will adopt which design, engineer A or engineer B?
Well, if I understand that the engineer A use the LTA CC criteria, which complies with the shaft friction alone, I will say that is safe enough. Although I don't like the pile to be sit in that perhaps boulder. That's what I don't like about that design. But if that pile is basically checked for friction alone, I will say that's okay.
Okay, so there's a background. I hear my own background. Okay, you get off your mic. So, Giotaro from Argentina choose that B is a he say B is okay because it satisfies the shaft friction or no. He doesn't depend on the end bearing from the boulder. Okay, to answer this question, take a look at this. This boulder is not so perfect circle, I just draw it over there. Now, do you think that even you satisfy the shell friction alone in the boulder is good enough? I leave it to you. What makes you think that the boulder cannot sink together with the pile? Richard, you call the Church Street case study. On site, how do you know this is not a boulder? Very difficult, actually. So it goes back to the most fundamental thing, geological map. If your geological map tell you are in the bouldery clay, then you need to do more soil investigation borehole. Okay? To capture that this boulder. Okay? And all your geological, or you must decide that your competent short term cannot be in bouldery clay. That means your SI bore must go to the geological formation below the bouldery clay. And you must specify that your pile cannot stop in bouldery clay. Simple as that. Okay? Even though it sounds simple, practically to apply means a lot of cost consideration, a lot of negotiation, a lot of judgment on site. So it's not so simple. It's not so simple. Okay, so this is the thing that I want to share with you. Now, conclusion, finally, we are ending. Sorry, 6 o'clock already. I touched on the difference between CP4 and EC7, the BCA guidelines and national annexes. EC7 using the alternative approach and designing according to the BCA AC checklist and integrating the design and construction with supervision on site and a step-by-step design on the ball pile. Okay, now I want to answer the PhD student. Is that the PhD student? Joel, who asked me about the why BCA changed the model factor from 1.2 and 1.4 to 1.35, 1.55, right?
Yes, yes.
Okay, if you make the number, if you calculate the number, if 1.35 and then go on the combi 2, okay, let me go to the combi 2. Oh shit, sorry. I must go to the combi 2. You look at the combi 2, what is the model, what is the model factor that you use? Okay, shell friction 1.4. If you multiply 1.4 and 1.35, it's 1.89, right? You notice here it's 1.89? Okay, so if you don't use 1.35, you use 1.2 only. It's about 1.68. Okay, so, but you don't forget, that is for the shaft check only. If you use the shaft check only, now the shaft check only is 1.3 already. Okay, so that is the, from what I think, what I feel, so they increase this 1.2 to 1.5 is to actually increase the factor closer to CP4. Remember in CP4, we use 2.5, right? The combi 2.5, right? 2.5, right? So you look at combi 2, actually they are closer to our CP4. You notice?
Yes, yes.
1.89 and 2.3 is closer compared to only using 1.2. Okay, so that is my take. That is why they actually increased to like that, to this. So that it's an improvement, it's a less conservative approach than CP4, but it's not so aggressively unconservative. That is my answer to you.
Right, thank you.
Now, so we've gone to the conclusion already. So it's a Q&A. Any more questions? Well, now dropped to 66 people only. Must be too long for you, but I to be frank, my previous seminar actually Nobody left. Okay, any questions?
Actually, hello.
Yes.
Hello, Jing here. I have a question. Hopefully it's a quick one. It's regarding the working load test and the determination of the test load for working load test and ultimate load test. So in BCA circular, we use the term characteristic load, which you mentioned that is similar to the working load back in CP4. Then yes. In EuroCode 7, the term used is a representative load. And the ultimate load test must be taken to the unfactored ultimate resistance, if I don't remember wrongly. So in practice, how do we determine this test load in accordance to EuroCode 7? Because in last, if I'm not wrong, working load in CP4 typically refer to like, let's say one day load plus one life load. But in EuroCode, we don't use the term working load anymore. So in practice, how do we determine the test load?
Good question. To answer your question, we need to look at the criteria again. Where is the testing requirements? Wait, let me see. Give me a minute. EC7 design approach. Oh, it's further on top. Sorry. My bad. Because the screen is all occupied by you already. Okay. Load test. Okay. Your question, you are Jing Ying, right?
Yeah.
Jing Ying, right? You are a student? You are a student?
Yes, first year MSc.
But you are a consultant, right?
Yes.
Okay. So to answer your question, in the EC7, they also talk about the load test. Okay. They also call I think it's called a proof load test, if I'm not wrong. I need to check again the name they use. Okay, the proof load test. The proof load test. Okay. So you look at the circular that's given to you, they still use the word ultimate load test, working load test, right? But in actual fact, we don't know what is the working load. You also don't know what is the ultimate load, right? You know what I say, right?
Yes.
So typical ultimate load test in the past is 2.5 times to 3 times the working load. And if you can recall the definition that I say previously, the working load now is actually called the characteristic action, or you can call it the characteristic load for you to easy to remember. So in this case, it's very clear. So today, I want to test a power. I say this is the ultimate load test. So the contractor will ask me, hey, what is the load you want to test to? How much you want to test, right? I will say I want to test to 3 times. Last time I would say I want to test to 3 times the working load. Okay, test to 3 times. So what is the working load? In this case, the working load is the characteristic load for EC7.
Mm.
Okay, does that answer your question?
Okay, meaning let's say I have this group of columns sitting on the piles of the same type. Then, for example, I can just consider like one day load plus one life load of the highest column load among this group of piles, something like that.
Yes. Let's say you design 1 meter diameter, right? But in different location, the column load is different, right? So, of course, you choose the largest characteristic load to test, right?
Okay.
Right? Okay. Common sense, right? Common sense, right?
Understand.
Okay.
Thank you.
No problem. Any more questions? Hey, I show this screen again, y'all please. Because if I further lectures, you all can webinar I conduct, you may not be able to attend whatever. You can log into here, you can see. Okay, usually I upload the videos here. You can subscribe to the YouTube, whatever is whatever convenient to you. Okay, so I have no problem. So the next topic that I'm going to talk to is, you see, remember this cycle? We talk about the prelim design, right? The next topic I'm going to talk is about testing and monitoring, which I think is more interesting. And I can guarantee you, many people don't know. Okay? Many people don't know. Really, many people don't know. Got one engineer come for P interview. When the interview asks him, so I give you a power load test. Do you know how to see the interpret the power load test? His answer is, this is done by the specialty contractor. Okay? I think he straight away failed the interview. That means he had never read the power test report before, or he just goes straight to the conclusion that whether the settlement passed or don't pass. Simple as that. Okay. Now, what I'm going to talk is in the next lecture is type of tests and the purpose, limitation, your responsibility, how you plan your program, how you do your QAQC, how you interpret, that's most important, and if application. And of course, I'll give you a case study how we do, or how I do. I will say how we do, how I do. Okay, I hope that will be interesting. So, yeah, any more questions? Wow, this group is very, very quiet. Very, very quiet. So if not, Prof, you want to say something to end? I have nothing already.
Okay, I'll just turn on my video first. Yep. Thank you very much, Mr. Lim. Actually, giving us a very interesting and webinar, which is full of practical insight. I think some people leave because it is probably on a Friday evening. appointments outside, you know. Maybe we try what? Norella. Norella, can you hear me? You know, Norella? Hey, can you unmute yourself? Hello? Okay. Okay.
Yes, I can.
Okay, the next, if we are going to have another one, can we have it a little bit earlier in the day rather than 4 o'clock?
Oh, the other time we have it in the morning, 10.
No, I mean, you don't have to have it at 10 o'clock. You can have it at 3 o'clock. I mean, I'm not asking you to wake everybody up, you know.
But usually, we let the speaker to choose the time.
Okay. I thought you choose 4 o'clock this time. I thought it was chosen by you.
No, it's me.
Okay.
Is
it okay with you if we do it a bit earlier so people will be more...
I'm fine.
Okay. So,
promise if I have another one. I
mean, it's up to you, you know. It's up to you. So, I'm fine. I'm fine either way. Yeah, okay. So, I take it that there are no more questions from the audience. Actually, I just have one question which I really want to find out. I'm not...
Oh, yes, please, sir.
Yeah, on a practical side, these days, because like you say, the loads are getting bigger and bigger and people are using either bigger piles or deeper piles and all kinds of things. And there seems to be some kind of move towards like either deeper pile or bigger pile. And one way of getting a bigger pile is obviously to use a barret. So if you use a barret, your pile load test, your barret can have very high load. Question is, have you ever come across a case whereby you cannot load a pile to the ultimate load with the largest can latch you have? Does it ever happen or not?
Oh, yes. Actually very common. That's the reason why, especially for barrel pile and for viaduct jobs, for LTA viaduct jobs, the load get higher. I think Prof Chu was involved in this project as well. They actually have to do a stagmatic test.
Stagmatic test. Yeah.
But like I say, okay, today we never talk about barrel piles, so we focus on ball piles. In ball piles, if the canage become too heavy, right, of course, we can still do the O cell, right, the Osterberg cell test, which is also very uncommon in Singapore because not so much about interpretation, but general feedback, I'm not commenting on the test, general feedback is the results are not so good for the O cell test. Okay, the general result is not. So yes, there is such an instance whereby the canage is too heavy that we cannot conduct. Now, let me go back to answer your question again. Nobody say in the code, you today one project, you have 600, 800, 1 meter, 1.2 or 1.6. Nobody say that you must do on the largest diameter. Of course, in the largest diameter, we expect due to workmanship, due to construction limitation, the shaft friction and end bearing are likely to be smaller than a small diameter pile. Okay, that is likely only. But in actual fact, there's no code governing. But if you refer to LTA criteria, CDC criteria, LTA, CDC require you to check on the, where is my LTA table, LTA CDC requirement. Okay, you look at LTAC, right? For example, viaduct, one per pile type and pile size for each representative ground condition. Wow, very long in there, you know. Means what? One per pile type means today you have one pile is ball pile, one location then is barrel pile. You need to do separate pile test.
Yeah.
Okay, so one per pile and pile size. So let's say your pulse is all ball pile, you don't need to do all the different diameter of the ball pile. You don't need to do all the different diameter of the ball pile. You just do one type for each representative condition. Also, usually within the viaduct, the pier, the soil condition cannot vary by so much because the pier is quite a localized location. So not so much of this issue. Okay, not so much of this issue. So actually none of the code say that you cannot use a 1 meter. In fact, usually I will say the test pile within 1 to 1.2 is good enough. Even though you design, the maximum wall pile I see is 2 meter. So, I mean, no, 2.2. Sometimes they design up to 2.2. But we don't test on a 2.2 because one side, usually this big diameter is not the majority, will not make up the majority numbers. The majority number will be between 1.1 meter to 1.6. So I will say 1 to 1.2 is a good size to choose for ultimate load test. But you can choose to do the working load test on a big diameter part whereby the cannage requirement is lesser to test the performance of the big diameter piles. Does that answer your question, sir? That's the best answer I can answer you.
Okay, yeah. I think basically it does, because there are certain, what I'm trying to say, that there may be certain circumstances where your piles are generally quite large for special development, for special development. Mm. So my sense is that in that case, reaching working load is usually not a problem.
Working load not a problem, yes.
Can be a bit of a problem, and then people will need to use the ultimate load test to prove their design parameters. That's usually that may be where the problem can come up in practice, because the ultimate load test is used, like you say, is needed to actually derive to prove the parameters, to ensure that the parameters that you use, that we used in the design, is actually conservative. So right. Yeah, but I think you give us some nice pointers in the sense that we can play around a little bit with the pile size and maybe do a little bit of dynamic test. Osterberg test is always a bit tricky unless you believe in Osterberg test, you know. And also the thing is that if you haven't put in the Osterberg cell right at the beginning, you're kind of fixed.
Right. But Osterberg cell we usually do for ultimate load test. We can do for ultimate load test as well. Yeah.
Yeah.
We don't use O cell for working load test, because working load test, cannage can easily solve the problem unless site got constraint. Yeah, unless
site got constraint. But you have to have that expectation first, otherwise you wouldn't have put it in then.
Right.
So anyway, thanks very much, Gary. I think that is a nice answer, good answer to, good pointer for me going forward. So without further ado, I think I will not hold you back anymore. It's 6:30.
No, I'm fine. Oh, I forgot to tell you what's the answer, right? Remember, I give you all this. Okay, for those who need some career planning or guidance, let me share with you something. As for those who are graduation, I come back to this slide. It seems that the more you know, the more work you need to do, and the less money you're going to get, right? Sounds familiar to Prof. We are probably the most knowledgeable to all of us.
Yeah, I'm in need of money indeed. <most likely. laughs>
So, but I want to, for those students of y'all who are looking for a job, I just have a pointer. I just want to share with you. Those who are busy, you can free to leave. I know this is just a personal sharing, right? I graduated in year 2000, right? Year 2000 was the IT bubble burst, in case you don't know. And many of my cohort, for the 3 to 6 months, they cannot find jobs. And some of them who find jobs, right, after working for 3 months, they are not paid at all because the company just go bankrupt. Okay. Then 1 year later, we have the 911 attack. Then suddenly the jobs market is not certain anymore. And 2003, we have the SARS. Of course, 2007, we have the global financial crisis. Just I want to share with you, you think this COVID-19 is going to be a new game changer, or it's not that good? There's the new norm is not going to be able. I'm telling you, you don't need to think about this thing. You just need to focus on yourself. Actually, the answer to this equation, which seems something wrong, actually is the more knowledge you know, actually the more value you add. You are not being paid for your time. You know? People say, hey, I pay you $150 per hour, lawyer pay about $300 per hour. But actually I disagree. You are paid for the value you add. You get a more perspective. If people think you can add more value. Okay, to be frank, and to be frank with you, many companies ask me to recommend engineers to them. You know, on my hand, I have two openings. Okay, I have two openings, real openings. Okay, one is called an AC manager, one is called a technical director, both from big consultancy. They are looking people to fill the role. But going forward, I can assure you is that we need less people to do the same amount of work because of technology advance. I started off whereby FEM is not very prevalent, but now you know everybody using FEM and they even go to 3D FEM. Okay, so we are getting more and more efficient, but I'm not saying that we are getting more productive because I see that the fundamentals have been lost around the way. That's the reason why I conduct this webinar. I want to bridge the gap between what you learn in school, in the classroom and in the field. And then this gap is widening and it's getting worrying. Okay, it's really widening. I see for the last 10 years, I deal with so many engineers. I deal with consultants some more. I deal with big consultant, MNC consultant, whereby I was thrown to do work with a young engineer. I can tell you it's very dangerous. It's very, very dangerous. So my pointer to you is, if you're job hunting now, in the midst of job hunting, go and read out the code, go and read out the LTCDC, okay? Go and read out, go to the net. You can find many videos like mine that actually can refresh or teach you how to apply your knowledge. Whatever you learn now, actually to me is not knowledge. Even you graduate with master, PhD, or even the bachelor, it's not knowledge, it's just information. Okay, it's just information. You just have more information than those people who have not a degree. But only when you apply this information, then it becomes knowledge to you. So I hope you enjoy today's session. You can get me through email. My email is tersconsultant@gmail.com. I will type in the chat for those people who missed or left, so sorry for them. I will type in the chat. You can email me, okay? Or you can get hold of me through whether Facebook or LinkedIn, okay? But I don't guarantee I can answer them, all of them. So that's it. Yeah. So I hope you have a great weekend and you can connect with me if you have any questions. Yes, that's all. Thanks a lot. Thanks, Prof. Thanks for your hosting.
Mr. Lim, Engineer Lim Kiawi, I think all of us who attended actually enjoyed this very much. At least I myself thoroughly enjoyed it. So without further ado, maybe let us show our appreciation to Mr. Lim in the usual way. Of course, we can't clap on the webinar, but I think there's this reaction thing that you can use.
No, why don't everybody turn on your video so that I can take a photo of the video? But I don't know how, but I need to stop sharing my screen already. Yeah, I need to stop sharing my screen. Oh yeah, okay. Then don't put the spotlight on me and start to show everybody. Yeah, then I can take a photo to show that everybody is around. Although of course it's left already. Most people are left. Can you don't show the spotlight on us? Just show the main screen, yeah? That everybody is in?
Yeah, everyone is in.
Just show the grid.
The grid that everybody is in. Yeah. Like that. Yes. Wow. But I can't capture everyone. I try.
I think what you can do is you do a screenshot, then you move over to the
next two page.
There's two pages.
Two pages. Yeah,
You do a print screen first, then you go to the next page and do another print screen.
Yeah, I'm doing it. I am taking photo with my phone. It's okay, good. Oh, Gerardo, I remember you. You are the one who attended Prof. Wong lecture, right? Are you the one? No. Okay. Oh. Never mind. It's okay.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. So
Mr. Lim, I think thank you very much. I think you benefited a lot and it's quite enjoyable, very enjoyable seminar. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Have a good day. Bye-bye.